Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. I'm Francine Romero, and I'm an Associate Dean in the College of Public Policy at UTSA, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to San Antonio Central Library on this President's Day. Now, before we get to our important discussion of our new tax bill, it is my great honor to welcome and introduce our panel. I am going to start on our far right with Ann Beeson. Ann Beeson is the Executive Director of the Center for Public Policy Priorities in Austin. She is a renowned social justice lawyer, a former philanthropy executive, and frequent public speaker and writer. Ms. Beeson joined the center in 2013. She was previously the Executive Director of U.S. Programs at the Open Society Foundations, where she promoted human rights, justice, and accountability nationwide. Ms. Beeson was the National Associate Legal Director of the American Civil Liberties Union from 1995 to 2007. She argued twice before the U.S. Supreme Court and launched groundbreaking programs to stop the erosion of civil liberties in the name of national security and to protect free speech and privacy on the internet. Ms. Beeson has been recognized as one of the nation's top lawyers by American Lawyer magazine and the National Law Journal. A proud Texan, Ms. Beeson has embraced a wide range of innovative strategies to advance social change. She grew up in Dallas, received undergraduate and graduate degrees from the University of Texas, and obtained her law degree from Emory University School of Law. Congressman Joaquin Castro represents the Texas 20th Congressional District and serves on both the House Armed Services Committee and the House Foreign Affairs Committee. First elected to Congress in 2012, Congressman Castro was the 2013 co-president for the House Freshman Democrats and now serves in House Democratic leadership as Chief Deputy Whip. He has been called a rising star in his party by the Texas Tribune and one of the top 50 politicos to watch by Politico. Congressman Castro, who of course is from San Antonio, graduated from Stanford University and from Harvard Law School. At the age of 28, Congressman Castro was elected to the Texas legislature. While a state representative, he created the Trailblazers College Tour, raising money to send underprivileged students on college visits, exposing them to some of the nation's best institutions of higher education. He also founded SA Reads, San Antonio's largest literacy campaign and book drive. During his time in Congress, Congressman Castro has sought to build out what he calls the infrastructure of opportunity. Good public schools, great universities, and a sound healthcare system to enable his fellow citizens to pursue the American dream. And Congresswoman Nancy Pelosi is the Democratic leader of the U.S. House of Representatives for the 114th Congress. From 2007 to 2011, Congresswoman Pelosi served as Speaker of the House, the first woman to do so in American history. A graduate of Trinity. A graduate of Trinity College in Washington, D.C., Leader Pelosi represents San Francisco, California's 12th District in Congress, an area she has served for 30 years. She has led House Democrats for more than 12 years and previously served as House Democratic Whip. Under the leadership of Speaker Pelosi, the 111th Congress was heralded as one of the most productive Congresses in history by scholar Norm Ornstein. President Barack Obama called Speaker Pelosi an extraordinary leader for the American people, and the Christian Science Monitor wrote, "Make no mistake, Nancy Pelosi is the most powerful woman in American politics and the most powerful House Speaker since Sam Rayburn a half century ago." Working in partnership with President Obama, Speaker Pelosi led House passage of the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act in early 2009 to create and save millions of American jobs and provide a tax cut to 95% of working Americans. Additional key accomplishments signed into law under the leadership of Speaker Pelosi include ethics reform legislation, an increase in the minimum wage, the largest college aid expansion since the GI Bill, and a new GI education bill for veterans of the Iraq and Afghanistan wars. With the House Democratic Caucus, Leader Pelosi continues to focus on the need to create jobs in America and prevent them from being shipped overseas and to fight for bigger paychecks and better infrastructure for America's families. Well, let's begin our discussion of what has been called the most consequential tax legislation in 3 decades. We are going to begin with some startup questions, and then we will get to your audience questions. So, Ms. Beeson, we're going to start with you and go on down the line. Do you believe this bill is going to help people who were left behind in the economic recovery?
Of course not. I don't think it's going to at all. And I think that to understand the impact here in Texas, it's very important to understand the challenges that we were already facing here in Texas. And that is due to decades of underinvestment in critical services by our state government. And the concern is that this tax bill is going to make the rest of the country look a lot like Texas. We hear a lot about the Texas miracle, but the question is, miracle for whom? Yes, we have a booming economy here in the state, but that is mainly benefiting people at the top and not people at the bottom. Despite the wealth of our state, we have entrenched poverty. 1 in 4 Texas children lives in poverty. We have the 10th highest rate of low-wage jobs in the country. We are one of the top 10 states for income inequality, and we have 4.5 million Texans who still lack health insurance. Why do so many Texans lack these things? Well, it's not because we don't have the resources, we know that. It's because of deliberate choices made by our leaders. And to the extent that we have any kind of safety net here in Texas, guess what? That is due to the federal government. That is due to federal spending here in Texas on programs that unfortunately are going to now be targeted, and we know that from President Trump's budget and many things that have been said by Speaker Ryan. Many of those programs that are benefiting Texans here at home are very much at risk because of this tax bill.
Thank you. That was a great summary, Ann. And thank you, everybody, for being here. We appreciate you all coming for this discussion, and also to have Democratic Leader Pelosi here in San Antonio. At this particular time, after a major piece of legislation, a sweeping tax bill was passed not too long ago. But before we get into that, I wanted to say there were just 2 pieces of legislation, significant ones, that were left out of what she helped pass. First was the Affordable Care Act, many years ago, that helped ensure millions of Americans. And then, as I've said on many occasions, that she was the only leader in Washington who passed the DREAM Act back in 2010, I want to say. Yeah, you know, I voted against the tax bill, and I had big concerns with it. Most of all, that the concentration of benefits goes to people at the very top in terms of wealth in American society, and really to big corporations. So 83% of the benefits basically go to the top 1%. Now the question is why you would be doing that in a time when income inequality has just been getting larger and larger, when really the wealthy are getting wealthier and the poor are getting poorer. Not only that, but the middle class is also suffering. You know, our town, the city of San Antonio, is a place where many individuals and families are still aspiring up the economic ladder in America. And so this bill is harmful for people who are still on their way up, who are still trying to make their way up that economic ladder. I think over the years we're going to see the pernicious effects that it has. We were speaking earlier about the fact that there's about a $1.4 trillion cut to Medicaid, which hurts the very poorest Americans who can't afford health care coverage, who often struggle to make payments on either if they're maybe some own homes, but many of them are making rental payments, for example, who struggle oftentimes even to put food on the table. So it's a significant cut to Medicaid, but also about a $500 billion cut to Medicare, which our seniors are so dependent upon. So you know, as we think about these things and the effects of the long-lasting effects of this tax bill that won't pay for itself, by the way, this is something that's going to run up the deficit and the debt, which already stands at now over $20 trillion. When we think about these things, I think we don't have to even think about other people's lives. We think about our own lives and our family members. And I often think about my grandmother who, after working for decades, she started working when she was a child, literally a child, because she lived in a household where everybody had to go work to support each other. So after working for decades and decades, when she could no longer work because she had type 2 diabetes, the only thing that she had to her name, she never owned a car or a house. As far as I know, I don't know that she ever had a bank account. Maybe she did. But the only thing that she had coming in every month, and the reason that she could never live by herself, but she always lived with my mom, is because she was relying on a $335 a month Social Security check. So that is what is at stake for many of our senior citizens, is they're basically their lifeblood and what they have to live on. And so we'll have a chance to talk some more about these issues, but I'm very concerned about the future of this legislation.
Thank you, Francine. It was wonderful to be here with you and with Anne, and appreciated your comments. Of course, an honor to be here with your distinguished member of Congress, Congressman Joaquin Castro. Thank you for sending him into Congress. If I stand up, but I'm so honored to be with you, and enough has been said about us, but you're the special ones. You've taken time from a holiday to give of your time to come to share in a conversation. We can learn from you, and you can hear some of the concerns we have about this tax bill, which has a very serious impact on our prospects. And I'm just reading from this one card, because we gather here on George Washington's President's Day, well, not present, but particularly George Washington and Abraham Lincoln. And with George Washington, I had the privilege of going last week to now very bipartisan way pay tribute to George Washington. I read this card to my colleagues. It said, as a young schoolboy, George Washington transcribed 110 rules of civility and decent behavior, a list of Jesuit-inspired moral maxims. And this is what the president said. Labor to keep alive in your breast the little spark of celestial fire called conscience. Called conscience. Now, I bring that up on this day because of what it is, but also because of what this subject is. This tax bill is bad not only in itself, but for what it does to the budget. Our national budget should be a statement of our national values. What is important to us as a country should be how we invest in the education of our children, in the health and well-being of the American people, in the defense of our nation, the values that make our country great. But this bill, but the budget that the president just presented falls very short, doesn't even come, it is not values-based, nor does it have that spark of conscience. And this is why, this is one of the reasons why. That tax bill is a dark cloud that hangs over the Capitol. As Congressman Castro said, 83% of the benefits of a bill go to the top 1%. We call the middle income tax cut. 86 million middle income families will pay more under this bill. They give a $1.3 trillion tax cut to corporate America, and with interest that goes over $2 trillion added to the deficit. They give tax breaks to corporate America to send jobs overseas. If you want to set up a shop to create jobs overseas, you get a tax break compared to doing that here. So the list goes on and on. I can answer some more specific questions about what's in there, but that's just some of it. So that when it comes time for the budget, they say, we don't have any money because we have a $2 trillion tax cut. Well, they just created that. Added, it's a $7 trillion, but they're $2 trillion additional. Just think if they'd spent $1.3 trillion on infrastructure in our country instead of a tax cut to corporate America. Does corporate America need to have a lower tax rate? Well, let's sit down and discuss that because Dean Romero said earlier, this is the most consequential tax bill in 30 years. The last one, 30 years ago, 1986, not that long ago, oh, you can go over that too, and 1986 was done over a period of time in the wide open with expert testimony as to the ramifications of one approach or another, and in a bipartisan way. Bipartisan, transparent, unifying. That's what everything we do should be. But that's not what this tax bill speed of light in the dark of night, a bill that was practically being written as they were voting on it, and a bill that is all about the high end at the expense of the progress for the middle class and certainly those who aspire to it. So because of what it is and its unfairness, because of what it adds to the deficit, it's bad enough. But what it does to our opportunity for the budget is really what is damaging. And as Congressman Castro said, exactly the same in that $1.3 trillion we're giving to corporate America, they're cutting $1.4 trillion from Medicaid. And while Medicaid is for poor children, two-thirds of the people on Medicaid are poor children. Two-thirds of the money, but that only accounts for one-third of money. Two-thirds of the money is spent largely, over 60%, for seniors in assisted living, either in home or at home. So this is a middle-income benefit that affects many people in our country. And then, of course, cutting $500 million out of Medicare, which they've already said they would like to take away the guarantee and make it a voucher. So this is a way, the tax bill is an end in itself, so let's trickle down tax cuts at the high end of the expense of the middle class. But in addition to that, it gives them the predicate, the excuse they need, that they're going to starve the beast, and the beast is the American people, and the middle class and those who aspire to it. So it's about the bill and its unfairness, but it's also about the cost to the budget, making us, and the president's budget, $200 billion plus cut from food stamps. So we get people buying for processed food instead. I mean, really? Really? So where's that spark of conscience that's supposed to fire a budget which is a statement of our values? The combination of the two of them is really very detrimental to our investments in the future. And if you want, we can talk about what it does to infrastructure as well, because attorneys recently said that, well, we can't have a big infrastructure proposal because we have just added to the debt. Oh, really? So in any event, for these and other reasons, it's important for people to understand, because they'll spend close to $100 million misrepresenting what this bill does out there. But it is really hard to exaggerate the damage that it does. But we don't agonize, we organize, and we will continue to make the fight so the public understands what they have done and educate, hold Democrats, Republicans, everybody accountable for decisions that are made as we go forward. I'm proud that 70% of Democrats voted against this tax bill, but it's important for Republicans to know that people understand and are paying attention, and we deserve better as a country to honor the values of our founders on this weekend. I thank you for honoring us with your presence. You're very special people spend this time. Thank you. And moms demand action.
The next question I wanted to get to is, what do you think of companies giving bonuses in response to the savings that this bill represents, but not increasing wages? And more broadly, what do economists expect corporations to do with their big tax savings? Whoever would want to tackle this first.
Well, you know, it's like giving people, giving a turkey at Thanksgiving, saying, I gave out all these turkeys at Thanksgiving. That's really nice. But it's no substitute for increasing people's wages. This tax bill, plus this budget, plus they're saying, well, we need bonuses. No, how about increasing people's wages? Democrats have a better idea. It's called a better deal, better jobs, better wages, better future. How we can increase the paycheck of the American worker. That's the most vital thing that we can do to grow our economy, is to give consumer confidence to the middle class, and again, those who aspire to it, so that they will have confidence, spend, inject demand into the economy, grow the bring money to the treasury, grow the economy, and create more jobs. So when they say they're giving a bonus, well, we're talking about just a small percentage of the $1.5 trillion plus dollars that they're given. They're really giving a small percentage of these. But largely, you'll see buybacks and and the rest of that, the woodlands and the rest, to shareholders. That's not a bad thing. We're just saying, it is what it is, don't try to pass it off. It's a banquet at the high end. They criticize me for saying a banquet at the high end comes to the middle class. Don't insult our intelligence by saying that. So it's nice that they're getting a bonus. Some of those bonuses were part of the union contracts anyway, so there was nothing additional. Some were additional, and we'd just like to see better jobs, better pay, better future, and not no less of leadership, condescension, someone got a tax cut. Now, in the past, we have said to them, we will be happy to work and lower the corporate tax rate if we can see a guarantee of jobs. You want to bring your money from overseas? Bring it overseas, but create jobs here. We just have to see evidence of that. But until we can see bigger paychecks, it's just all about trickle down. We wanted to see a bubble up.
I couldn't agree more, of course, with the focus on wages being the only thing that's really going to get us out of this situation where we have entrenched poverty in the cities, you know. We have seen, you know, wages stay stagnant for decades in this country. And so I often like to tell the story, you know, I'm not so young anymore. I know we have students, a lot of students in the audience. When I went to college, I was actually able to put myself through college with the income of a part-time job and actually pay my rent and pay my tuition without a single dollar having been spent by my parents. You all know that you can't do that anymore. And one of the reasons why is because wages have not gone up. And the other reason why is because the cost of college is exploding. Why is the cost of college exploding? Because the federal and the state government, especially here in Texas, have disinvested in public education in our universities. It's just such a challenge. And again, it's another way you see some of these bad ideas that we've had here in Texas for a while coming to the national level with things like this tax bill.
Sure, no, and I think it's been well said. But look, companies giving bonuses is a good thing, right? Somebody gets extra money in their paycheck, that is a good thing. But the fact is that a lot of those same companies, when they announced the bonuses to employees, they also announced layoffs a week or two later. So there were a big round of layoffs. And one of the constant battles that we've had in the Congress is about getting the U.S. Chamber of Commerce and others in the business community to join us in advocating for a higher minimum wage. Now, to their credit, some companies have done that. But the institutions that lobby in Washington, D.C. have been adamant against increasing the minimum wage that has not been increased since 2009, literally in 9 years. Now, a lot of people might think, well, you know, I don't work for the minimum wage, and nobody in my family works for the minimum wage, so how does that really affect me? Or my job obviously pays more than minimum wage to start. But once you increase the minimum wage, there's a good chance of also increasing the wages at other positions. So I think it's important, that's why we push to raise everybody up. And unfortunately for years, many groups have been intransigent in not wanting to do that. Because in addition to one-time bonuses, we have to get to the place where we can raise wages for everybody.
Okay. There are a lot of young people here today, a lot of students. Now this new tax bill will add $2 trillion additional dollars to the national debt. What does this mean in a practical sense for Americans in general, and in particular young people across the country?
Have you looked at it?
Basically, between the tax bill and this latest budget that was passed, we're looking potentially at having, basically being adding $2 trillion to the debt annually. Remember, we're at $20 trillion right now. So the folks that are going to be most affected are people that are even younger than myself. I'm 43. So you're going to have a generation of people who are basically saddled with a lot of debt. Now, this is on top of the fact that you've already got a lot of college students who are drowning in debt right now, right? Sometimes struggling to adjust to the fact that the workplace is changing, that technology in many ways has come to dominate more often the types of jobs that are available. So for many years, especially folks on the other side of the aisle spent time railing against President Obama and the fact that they didn't want to pass any spending bills or anything that would increase the debt or the deficit, when in fact this has not just the potential but will increase the debt substantially, affecting all of us, but I think possibly crippling the younger generations.
Well, I would just add on to that, just to kind of, again, share some Texas numbers. The federal government spends $5 billion in providing aid to undergraduate students, financial aid, here in Texas. And there's just no question that that's just the type of program that's going to be, you know, targeted for cuts. And again, we've heard those conversations already. Here in Texas, that's 7 times the amount of money that the state government spends on financial aid. So, you know, when this disappears, if this, you know, federal money disappears or is reduced substantially, you know, you're going to have an even worse situation than you're currently facing, you know, with college debt, and making it much, much more unlikely that a lot of people, you know, will be able to even go to college at all here in there.
From the standpoint of the debt and the future, this is theft. It is stealing from young people's future. Because when you have debt and increased debt, you have increased interest on the debt. And that is like just burning money right in front of your very eyes. It buys nothing except pays interest on a debt. And I think it's important for me to say this because it's counterintuitive in people's minds that the Democrats are the debt reducers, but we are. When President Clinton was president, we instituted something we were waiting, you know, we need a Democratic president to do. And even we did a little bit under President George Herbert Walker Bush when he agreed to the budget agreement. And that is pay as you go. You want something, you offset it. You either cut something or you pay for it. And that includes tax cuts. The Republicans are very interested in making us pay for food stamps, but they don't think you have to pay for tax cuts. But a tax cut is an expenditure. You're spending money. So we're spending young people's money into the future, increasing the interest on the debt, which is an opportunity cost for other investment for them. So pay as you go is what we would like to see. When President Clinton, we had that. His last 5 debt budgets, 4 or 5, if you want to argue one of them, were either in balance or in surplus. Pay as you go. We were on a path of reducing the national debt, not adding to it. President Bush came in, got rid of pay as you go, gave tax cuts to the wealthy, and two unpaid for wars, a giveaway to the pharmaceutical industry, high cost of drugs, all that, and we went in the opposite direction, a swing of $11 trillion from deficit, debt reduction to debt increase. So now under President Obama, it went down again. President Obama, when he came into office, the deficit, not the debt is the ongoing, the deficit is the annual. The deficit was at $1.4 trillion. When he left, it was $530 million, it was like a 70% decrease in the deficit, and that means lowering what is added to the debt. They came in, threw out pay as you go, and now we're on this path again. So for kids, what is important is the investments that we make in broadband and net neutrality opportunity, all of the things that provide opportunity for jobs for the future, reducing the cost of education, reducing the cost of them payments. You know, in other words, just the business of living, whether it's prescription drugs if their family needs them, the cost of their communications, all the rest of that. But if you don't have that shared purpose, which is to make things affordable, and you have this big debt and interest on the debt, you are stealing from our children's future, just as if you just took money out of their pockets. And that is something that when we're at the table discussing the debt and the budget and the rest of my Republican colleagues are, well, we can't heap mountains of debt on our children. I said, but you are. You are. And for example, if you want, I'll say to them, let's find some places that we can reduce the debt. So I made one suggestion to them of a $38 billion expenditure. I said, we could take this out. This is not necessary. It's just not necessary. And they said, why would we do that when we can save the same amount of money by cutting Pell Grants? And I said, may I tell people you said this? They said, no, it's in our proposal. That's who we are. But understand this. That's one of their dumbest ideas. I mean, the stiff competition for bad ideas. Because nothing brings more money to the treasury than investment in education. Early childhood, K through 12, higher education, post-grad, lifetime learning for our workers. And in the interest of the budget, you know, their view of the budget, they're cutting on all of that training and apprenticeship and the rest of that in their budget. And so those are, you know, in the here and now initiatives that affect young people, but in our reluctance to do an appropriate, their unwillingness to do an appropriate bill that is about infrastructure that builds broadband across America, which is where the jobs of the future are for many of our young people. I'd like to hear what some of our young people have to say about that too. So at the table, when they speak for young people, I said, let's hear them speak for themselves. Who are we to speak for young people?
Okay, you've all alluded to this a little bit, but I want to get a little bit deeper into Medicare and Medicaid. So almost immediately after the bill passed, Speaker Bryan made public comments about the need to reduce spending on Medicare and Medicaid and tackle the debt and deficit. What does this mean for programs Americans rely on, like Medicaid and Medicare?
Well, I think that it means that he's willing to trade or give up on programs like Medicaid and Medicare and instead funnel that money to the wealthiest folks. That's basically, if you look at the budget, if you look at some of the things they try to do in the budget, if you look at the tax bill, that's essentially what you have, is that you're trading the benefits to one set of Americans who are middle class and below, and basically funneling it up to the top to very wealthy corporations and the wealthiest among us.
And again, just to bring in some Texas numbers, you know, we have 27 million people in our state, so it's not surprising that we would have such high numbers on some of these federal programs. You know, we have 3.9 million seniors in Texas who are on Medicare. And you know, that's just a huge number of people whose health care could be at risk if you see big cuts. Medicaid, we have 4.2 million Texans on Medicaid. 3 million of those are children. Leader Pelosi referred to that. 50% of the births in Texas are paid for by Medicaid. Okay, who is going to pay for those births? Who is going to pay for the health care for those 3 million children if you see these massive cuts that we need?
And one other point with regard to Medicaid, Medicaid pays for two-thirds of the nursing home stays in the country. So it's not only young people and folks giving birth, but also literally, you know, that's how my grandmother was able to stay in a nursing home. Because otherwise, my family could have never afforded, I think many of our families, right, could never afford to have somebody day in and day out at a nursing home. So that, as we think about getting older, that's a daunting thing also, that it's going to be that way.
And you know, it's like, go back to when these programs were founded decades ago. They were founded specifically to reduce the number of elderly people living in poverty. There's no question that if you see cuts to these programs, you are going to see a rise in the number of Texas seniors living in poverty. There's just nowhere.
And also, you know, basically, you have senior parents, more people that have to go and take care of their parents mm-hmm. who are aging, have to quit jobs, have to work part-time, have to leave work early, and obviously that has a significant effect on people's lives and their earning abilities, too.
If I just may add to that one thing, I agree with everything that has been said. It's important to remember that our veterans, 1.1 million veterans take advantage of Medicaid. A 500,000 veterans, food stamps. We really have to remember that this is part of what that is, and the, again, Social Security, Medicare and Medicaid, the Affordable Care Act, pillars of economic and health security for our seniors and our families. It's not just seniors. When I meet with the high school students and college students who come to tell me what they're thinking about the budget in the future, they include in their concerns, they say they want a good education, they want a better job prospect, they want libraries, here we are, and they want financial security for their grandparents because that enables their parents to take care of themselves as well as their children, so they see it as family. But the Republicans did not support Medicare and Medicaid when it was instituted. Eventually, they voted at some point, but they opposed it all along because they, bless their hearts, they don't believe in a public vote, and they are sincere in that regard, bless their hearts. But that's not a blessing in the hearts of other people who really need to see our society be responsible for each other in a sense of community that really is not a safety net for these individuals. It's insurance that they paid into in most cases, but it is a safety net for our capitalistic system, our whole society, to be able to have the agility and the ability to invest and to be entrepreneurial and the rest, because we have these insurance and initiatives in place, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid. So they cut Social Security disability benefits in their budget. I mean, really? So they could give a tax cut to the top 1% in the country. I don't think that top 1% really even, well, some of them maybe, but by and large, I think the enlightened self-interest of all is to say, when our entire community succeeds, our country succeeds.
I want to start transitioning to our audience questions, and we already talked a little bit about the people who were left behind, but more specifically, one of our background questions was, how is the new tax bill going to affect the rising inequality we see across America and in Texas? And then we had someone who didn't put their whole name, but they said MPA student, UTSA. What are the Democratic Party's plans, specifically the Democratic Party's plans, to address growing income inequality? So does the MPA student who submitted that question want to just raise their hand? We won't call you up or anything, but okay, all right, good, thank you for that. Okay, so in general, how will the new tax bill affect the rising inequality, and what does the Democratic Party propose to do about that?
Well, let me just say this, and I thank you for your question, because every question is an opportunity. So here's the thing, and I just want to just give you this little background, because to then pivot to where I think we need to go. One of the reasons we have the inequality in our, and the disparity in income, let me put it that way, the disparity in income in our country, is something that happened a few decades ago, three or four decades ago. Say 40 years ago, if you looked at, and don't take it from me, this is from the then chairman of the board of Standard Oil of New Jersey, you know, a person of a private sector, big deal. In those days, the disparity between the CEO and the worker was about 40 times. So when productivity increased, worker pay increased, CEO pay increased, all appropriate, 40 times. Around 30 years ago, it changed. And the way the CEO described it is, he said, in those days, management decisions were made based on not only the shareholder, which was the fiduciary responsibility, not only what was good for the shareholder, the management, the CEO, etc., but the employees, the customers, and the community at large. So decisions were made based on a more comprehensive view, at 40 times. Productivity increases, wages increase, everybody does better. And so the CEO pay increases, say about 40 times. Around 25, 30 years ago, it became shareholder capitalism. Before it was he called it stakeholder capitalism. Now it becomes shareholder capitalism. The only thing that matters is productivity rises, wages stagnate, they don't raise the wages, CEO pay increases because now he's made this money by not raising wages, so productivity gets no benefit to the worker, all of it to the shareholder, and CEO pay goes like that. I call it a right angle going in the wrong direction. And that when you're not rewarding productivity, well, that's just, that's spark of conscience. That's it. How can that be? I mean, if other countries did that, we'd say that's an unfair trade practice. But when we do it, we say it's a market. It's a free market. So, okay, so that's how we got into some of this fix. So what we're saying is, really, this isn't about any underserved. This is the great middle class, which is the backbone of our democracy, the middle class. And I said, all who aspire to it. But that middle class also has a union labor movement. A lot of the advantages that we got came from the work of unions as well. Safety in the workplace, all those kinds of things. Now here's the thing. We're always going to be in a fix unless we recognize the direct connection of consumer confidence to spending and therefore growth in our economy. So what they're doing with that tax bill, with that budget, is to stultify that very growth. And that's why we just have to say, getting to your question, Democrats have a better deal. That's a raw deal. We have a better deal. Better jobs, better pay, better wages, that is, and better future. Better future for Texas, as we say, better future for women, better future for rural America. Somebody just did one, my college Joe Crowder did one, better job, better future for the Bronx. You see it in your world. But it's a decision that a country has to make, that this is just not about the survival of the fittest, it's about our responsibilities to each other, and recognizing the pragmatics of saying, if people are confident and they're spending, the economy is growing, rather than the trickle-down economics of what the Republicans have stood for. Now, I don't want this to be so political, but the Republicans have stood for, they take pride in it. So they say it will pay for itself. It never has. And even some of their strongest proponents have said, while we believe in the supply-side economics, which is what this is, we never said it would pay for it. So anybody who tells you that, it's not true, it's nonsense. I went on to say it's BS. But that's what we're dealing with now. So this is pivotal for our country, because they've kind of made it easy by being so extreme in what they did with that tax bill at the cost of the middle class and those who aspire to it, and what that means to the budget. And they're almost proud of it. They're like, see, we put the predicate down so that we can cut Medicare, Medicaid, and the rest of that. But it is not the right thing to do. And you will see in our better deal, better job, better pay, better future, how we roll out jobs for the 21st century, and how we, our thing is building infrastructure in America in a grand, big way, and building human infrastructure in America, education, healthcare, well-being of the American people, and build our democracy by reducing the rate of money in politics and stopping Russians and others from interfering in our elections. All of this is what is part of the debate we're engaged in now, and that's what makes elections so important. And if you wish, at some point, we'll talk about topic A today. I don't know if anyone else wants to speak about Democrats.
I just wanted to just say, again, this is another example where Texas is the canary in the coal mine, right? Because we've already done this, right? We've already disinvested in public services like healthcare and education. And so it's no surprise that even though we're a wealthy state, we have one of the highest rates of income inequality. If you look at the numbers around the recession, a lot of talk about how Texas created a lot of jobs. Well, I'll tell you what happened. They waved a magic wand and converted a bunch of middle-class jobs to low-wage jobs, which is why we have one of the highest rates of low-wage jobs in the country. So again, you know, you're going to see that same kind of impact ripple beyond Texas with the impact of this tax bill. There's no question there's going to be rising income inequality.
Okay, we have a question from James Rivera. James, you want to raise your hand? There he is, James. James asks, when talk about wages comes up, the subject of inflation is also brought up. How can we raise wages but keep control of inflation?
We just had the new head of the Fed. The Federal Reserve is there to there's a charge at the Federal Reserve to report to Congress on a regular basis on inflation and unemployment and the relationship. And I was sitting as a new member of Congress in my seat by the Banking Committee, which is what it was called now, it's called Financial Services, it's expanded there now, when Henry D. Gonzalez was sitting in his chair. And one of the heads of the Fed came in and said, because some people at the Fed thought their sole role was only about inflation, but we think it's about employment and wages as well. And this head of the Fed said, unemployment is dangerously low. Unemployment is dangerously low. I was like, oh my gosh. And it was going to really pop. Because that's what it's dangerously low. Because for some people, inflation is no, we don't want a big inflation, but if the economy is doing better and wages are rising and people are spending and thriving and living their lives, you will get some inflation. But there is a whole element in our country, and part of that had influence in this tax bill. And their goal in life is to protect the value of their cash. So that means if wages should be kept low and unemployment should be kept high, that keeps their cash more valuable. And they're very wealthy people in our country, and they invest in foundations and charities and universities and all of that to fight the idea that we should have some balance here. Yes, if wages increase, there may be some increase in inflation. The Fed alters with interest rates, how that works. But we think that has to be a balance between inflation and job creation and wages, and not just about protecting the cash assets of the wealthiest people in our country. So that's a responsibility of the Federal Reserve. But it's also, I don't want to say a good problem to have, but even for our seniors and people who live on fixed income or savings, a little more inflation, a little higher interest rate gives them more income. So it's about balance. No, it's about balance. But it's not about starving the interest rates that people receive that they live on, in some cases, many of our seniors, or trying to be concerned that unemployment is dangerously low so that so we have no inflation. But it's called Humphrey Hawkins. Hubert Humphrey, Augustus Hawkins, they passed a bill called Humphrey Hawkins and said to the Fed, you're not just there to protect the assets of the extremely wealthy, you're there to make sure that there's a balance between employment, wages, and inflation as well. So, we'll see how it goes. I mean, again, it's about the balance. Does that answer your question? Thank you. You want to have that question about guns?
No, I have a question.
Well, if you want to answer those questions at all?
No, the only thing I would add to that, I think you're right. I think you need strong monetary policy that's basically monitoring what is going on in the U.S. economy, which is happening all the time. But also, when I think about the need for wage growth, I think about the fact that you still have many Americans who are drowning in debt. You still have a lot of people that are living paycheck to paycheck. So we have a lot of work to do in delivering higher wages to people. I mentioned the minimum wage, but it's not just people working for minimum wage, but at all the different, or many of the different wage classes in this country. So I feel confident that we can do that without driving prices through the roof.
Anthony, you want to? Okay, I'm just trying to read through the question I just got. And because they're telling me we just have time for one more question, I believe, and so I want to combine this a little bit. I've gotten a lot of questions that talk about what will the Democratic Party do if and when you retain some majority, House, Senate, both. So I did want to slip a quick question in, the sort of the predecessor to this one is, what impact do you see the tax bill having on the midterm elections or anything else on the midterm elections? And then more specifically, this is from a graduate mental health counseling student at UTSA. If you want to raise your hand as I read your question, thank you for this. And they say there's a portion of the tax bill that designates funds for mental health care, but to my understanding, it is limited to veterans. Mental health is more than that. We need more licensed counselors and psychologists to help with issues such as depression, anxiety, suicide, the crisis that just happened in Florida. We are valuing things more than people. What can government do to start funding these initiatives and crucial services?
On that point, I would agree, you're right, that we need to take mental health as seriously and treat it as seriously as we treat physical health. And one of the wonderful things that the Affordable Care Act did was to bring those two things closer to parity. I remember in 2011, I believe, I worked on just a small part of bringing mental health to closer parity with physical health. I worked on a bill on serious emotional disturbances in children. But you're right, we have a lot of work to do in making sure that the resources are available, of course, to our veterans, but also to the larger population so that they can get treatment when they need it.
Did you want to answer the first part of the question about the midterm elections?
Yeah, although this is an official event, so I don't want to get too political.
No, just
we can't. But yeah, look, I think Americans will have a lot to say in November of 2018 about what has been delivered by this Congress in terms of funneling up resources to the very top at a time in our country when the top 1% already have a significant chunk of the wealth in this country. And when I say that, we don't begrudge anybody doing well. I don't think we should begrudge anybody's success in business or in their endeavors. You know, we acknowledge that and we honor that in this country. At the same time, we also believe that there should be a fair investment in what y'all know I call an infrastructure of opportunity in our nation for everybody who's coming up, right? For everybody who hasn't made $10 million or $100 million yet, everybody that is working for themselves and their families. And what happened with that tax bill is that it took the resources for that infrastructure of opportunity, for things like great schools and universities, a strong healthcare system, a strong economy that pays good wages. It took that and diverted it up to the people that are already doing so very well and the people that literally need it least in the country. And that, I think, is part of the shame of that bill.
So I would just say that the thing that has kept me going for the last year and however long it has been in this dark period for our state and our country is
15 and a half months.
The groundswell of engagement at all levels of government that I have witnessed and seen. We're seeing it today in this room with all of you who came out on a holiday to be here. I have never seen the halls of the Capitol in Austin as crowded as I did the last legislative session. We have marches in every city around the country. Representing the nonpartisan, fiercely independent think tank, that it is absolutely critical that we hold, that we support our, that we elect candidates that stand for our values, and that we hold them accountable to those values.
I just may say that this tax bill and the budget implications of it are well beyond politics. This is so central to who we are as a country, in terms of the security of people and their families, the security of our nation. Our national security leaders have told the administration that this national debt is a national security issue, because it brings instability to our country. So I have this so far beyond Democrats and Republicans. It's about our nation. And again, as Leeson said, we have to have two ramifications. One is who gets elected, but who learns from what the people are thinking. Hopefully, one who gets elected has, and the one who may be elected who doesn't share views, but will listen and learn from people as to what they understand the impact of public policy on their lives. This being a Black History Month, also Martin Luther King said, the ballot. Legislation. Your life. There's a connection between the ballot, what happens in legislation, and people's lives is something that we have to make clear. And that's what we're trying to do in these tax learnings for us teachings. Hopefully mutually, but we learn from you. And this is a very big deal as to statement of values, our budget, and our budget priorities are. Whether it's, again, infrastructure to build America, whether it's human infrastructure to grow our people, whether it's infrastructure of our democracy. So much of it is at stake. And not to be a fearmonger, everything is an opportunity. We don't agonize, we organize. And hopefully that is in the spirit of bipartisanship, transparency, as well as in the spirit of unifying. E pluribus unum. That was what our founders had as their motto for many one. They could never imagine how many there would be or how different we would be. But they also knew that the success of our country was predicated on the fact that every generation would take responsibility to make the future better for the next. We came out as the American dream. People flocked to our shores. Immigrants coming with their hopes, dreams, aspirations, courage, optimism, determination, all American traits made America more American and continue to do so. That's why we fight for our dreamers. I saw a sign coming in here in the library that said, if you don't dream, your dream can't come true. And so these dreamers are dreaming not for only for themselves, but for America. And if I just may say, our moms demand action. Thank you for what you are doing. As Ed said, it's the outside mobilization. It's Save the Affordable Care Act. We didn't win the fight on taxes, but we won the debate, and we hope to continue to win that debate. And moms demanding action, kids in Florida demanding action, people demanding action will make a difference in all of this. So know your power, the power of voice, the power of showing up, most importantly, the power to vote. So, thank you.